want anybody, we want Dr. Ambedkar from Bombay, and that he should attend March 4th meeting. They realize how Ambedkar was valuable to the Constituent Assembly, and that he should be on the Constitution Committee. This is despite the fact that Dr. Ambedkar was so critical of Congress. He wrote a book, What Congress and Gandhi Have Done to Untouchable. Huge writing critical of Dr. Gandhi's views and Congress views. But Congress understood it and brought him back. And he played a very important role. They not only appointed him on the drafting committee, but also made the chairman of the committee and gave him the responsibility. He worked very hard, like a patriot. You must read the Thanksgiving lecture of 24th November, I think, 1950. Thanksgiving after the Constitution was submitted to the President and it was approved. There was a Thanksgiving function, thanks to the drafting committee and Dr. Ambedkar. Then you have to read Krishnamacharya, who himself was a member of the drafting committee, and Radhakrishna. And Krishnamacharya said in his speech that one of the members of the Constitution drafting committee expired. It was not replaced. One of the person from South India, because of his health, would not come. One went to USA, didn't come back. And I literally quote. So it happens that the entire burden of framing the Constitution falls on the shoulder of Dr. Ambedkar. And that despite his ill health, he has accomplished the task so nicely, so fully. Now this is his contribution in terms of hard work and other. But that is important. But what is important is, what is his intellectual contribution to the Indian Constitution, which let down the political, economic, and social structure of our country, and which hold it together. His intellectual contribution is immense, with his knowledge of Constitution and jurisprudence. I just want to give one or two examples and finish this portion, because I want to discuss other issues. His contribution to the concept of nation, his contribution how to deal with the problem of minorities, social and religious. I want to spend some time on that later. But let me say, by saying that when the first draft of the Constitution was submitted, about 7,700 questions were raised in return for the amendment and for discussion, out of which Dr. Ambedkar, the chairman of the drafting committee, accepted 2,070 or something, 700. And on 2,750, point, there was a discussion, and there were some of the issues were very, very contentious. It's Dr. Ambedkar, each time the issue was raised, he had to stand and clarify and express his view and arrive at a conclusion. One has to only read the Constitution document and see his vision, his clarity on several issues. One of the members finally in a Thanksgiving ceremony says that in the Constituent Assembly there will be cloud of dust, cloud of confusion, intellectual confusion. But when Dr. Ambedkar would come and arrive and clarify, the entire cloud will settle down. That was the clarity that he would bring on the issues. Now, I don't want to say too much on this, but I just want to say one thing, couple of things, which goes to his credit, a singular goes to his credit. That is that he wanted, one has to understand that he wanted a constitution of different type in certain respect. He wanted different economic structure, he wanted different political structure, but he didn't get it. That everything that he wanted is given in the state and minority. The memorandum that he submitted to the Constitution Assembly, that what should be your political structure, what should be your economic structure. I don't want to go into that. But the thing that he was able to do are very, very important, and those are of a national importance and a national character. They have to do list to the cause of the Dalit. Cause of the Dalit is the independent one on which he has really contributed much. The issues that he influenced and brought into the constitutions are the following. That is, that he wanted state socialism as a part of the economic system of the constitution. believing that Nehruji is a socialist, and so he wanted that we should not have only political structure defined in the constitution and its parliamentary democracy, but we should have also economic structure. And he suggested a particular kind of economic structure, that in nationalization of land, distribution of land to everybody, basic and key industry with government, education, health and insurance should be with the government, a sort of state socialism, state taking a lot of responsibility to bring an economic equality and all that. But he did not accept it. No, it was not considered. But he, as a result of that, he brought directive principle as a substitute. Directive principle, he brought it from the Ireland constitutions. And what are directive principle? Directive principle are not enforceable in the court of law. You cannot go. But directive principle are the principle which guides the state to undertake particular policies. And these policies are of social improvement and economic improvement. That the government should take a policy in a manner such that the social group, the women, the minorities should have a proper well-being. The policy should not be such that there is any inequality in the wealth ownership, social justice. These all goals are brought in, social and economic goals, into the directive principle. They are anyway binding on the government. If you look at the Supreme Court, it's Supreme Court decision in the later period, that what is the difference between fundamental right and what is the difference between directive principle. They say fundamental rights talk about political freedom, but the directive principle talk about social and economic freedom. And both are equally important. Both are the two legs of the Indian constitution, they said. Now, this was Dr. Ambedkar's singular contribution of bringing out a directive principle, giving the direction through which the state should form the policies. But he was also very strong supporter of unitary government, very strong government. He wanted a strong center. We had 56 principalities, princes, and we had presidencies, Bombay, Madras, Calcutta presidencies. 1935 Act recognized the power and autonomy of the princely state as well as the presidencies. And that is how bringing them together with their rights was the concept of federalism, which was in the mind of everybody. Dr. Ambedkar opposed and brought a clarity. He said, no, all princely state, all presidencies will be the states of India. So he used to call United States of India. He never called federalism. He said, we should unite on an equal term, no special privilege to princely state or for that matter, the presidencies. Now, unitary state, United States, and to make it strong, to overcome the decisive tendencies that we have of nationalism, he brought several instruments. Others also helped him, but his contribution, let me read for you. How did we bring the unity government? Common language, three language formula, Hindi, English, and regional language, teaching in regional language, but it's obligatory to learn Hindi and English, and carry on the central administration in English as long as Hindi is not spread everywhere. Smaller state, I'll come to that later on. Common fundamental and citizenship rights to everybody, no distinction was to anyone. Every citizen had equal right. He was also in favor of uniform civil and criminal law and code. Common system of administration. We have a single bureaucracy in this country. We have a state bureaucracy, but we have single bureaucracy. We have one military, and we have one CRP, a central force, which you can send from here to the south. Single and most important contribution. Very few knew. I have the idea as to what should be the form of judiciary. It's Ambedkar who came and clarified that we will have single judiciary. It's the Supreme All Court, right from Tehsil to district to state, will be under the Supreme Court. And that single judiciary will unite all of us. Single election commissioner. Not a state level. State level is a distribution of work, but single election commissioner. Now these are some of the administrative thing that he brought in, whereby India is united, whereby states are united, and where we can be unit. Now, this is the role, a pioneering role of Dr. Ambedkar in terms of scholarship as far as the constitution making was concerned. One has to, in fact, go into greater detail and study. If you look at each and every discussion, you can study his contribution. Now let me very briefly come to the 2-3 points and I'll stop there. The other contributions are very important. The first is on the state reorganization, question of women, question of minority, economic development, and of course the problem of the depressed classes. Let me take one by one very, very briefly. Now, as far as state reorganization is concerned, you know that in 1953 we wanted to have states. And a commission was set up, State Reorganization Commission, and the commission came with the recommendation, one language, one state. That's how we got 17 or 18 states. Dr. Ambedkar was the first one who gave a thought to it and brought out a book, Thoughts on Linguistic State. You must read it, very important. You are a student of politics or any other subject, but that's another issue. Dr. Ambedkar heavily criticized the State Reorganization Commission and gave an alternative criteria for the formation of the state. First, he said that there is no need to have one state, one language, one state. Why can't we have many states of the same language? Because it will break regionalism. And he gave a different map. I'll come to that later. Second, he said the size should be small. Why do we need a big state? Small size ensures the participation of the minorities and social group and religious minority in the governance. Financial feasibility. And fourth criteria he gave, that whenever you chart out the boundary for the state, see to it that particular community doesn't turn into a minority, religious or social. So he gave the four criteria based on the efficiency and governance, and gave a different map of the state. You must read, you must see that map of. And it so happened, nobody else written on that. It's Dr. Ambedkar who brought out that Thoughts on Linguistic State. This was a national issue. This was not an issue related to the minority and socially religious minority he brought as a criteria. But basically it was a national question. And remember well that all the state reorganization, that this new state that had happened after the independence, it was all based on that map in that particular book. You got Chhattisgarh, you got Jharkhand, you got Uttarakhand, you got Telangana. It's all proposed by Dr. Ambedkar. There are other states also who draw inspiration from that book and ask for the reorganization of the state. Now these are the national issues. Who will take a pain, spend months together and deal with the issue, read and write? It's only the patriotic man who can do it. Who has a concern about the country, who has a concern about the nation. Others talk about the nation without doing anything. But here is the person who work hard and find out the solution. When he was a law minister, he brought a Hindu code bill. And that was the right of women. Women did not have a right to property, did not have right to divorce, other rights. As a law minister, he brought the first bill that was right to women, what is called Hindu code bill. There was a massive opposition to Dr. because he believed in equality, both for all the sexes and groups. It is the irony of the fact that the Hindu woman went on a strike against the bill, against their own right. That's the influence of religion that we have. Here is Ambedkar who tried to give a right, and here are women who oppose on the name of Hinduism. That it's infringe of Hinduism. Finally, Nehruji surrendered and brought the bill, but in a stall. He said, we cannot take it bill as a whole, there will be a political issue. So brought the installment. What did Ambedkar do? Ambedkar submitted his resignation. He gave other reason also for resignation, but one of the most important reason was the right of woman, and he left. This was a national cause, half of the population of India. This is not a Dalit cause, remember. It includes Dalit women, it includes Muslim women. He didn't include minority women, but and earlier he has also written Rise and Fall of Hindu Woman in Mahmoodi Society. And he say he very, very vehemently argued that Manu was the responsible for the fall of the woman because he denied education right, religious right to the woman. And Buddha was the one who led to the elevation of the woman. Buddha created Buddhist Sangha, allowed the woman to join Buddhist Sangha. Religious right, which other, which in many other spheres they did not have. So he wrote about that. So he had a background. Rise and Fall of Hindu Woman is available in any of the books written by Dr. Ambedkar. So he was committed, not he was not doing it as a law minister. So this is a national issue. Now let me come to the other one or two points before I come to the contribution issue of minorities and nation, the idea of nation that he built up and conceived. See, he also played a very important role in developing the economic strategy and perspective for Indian development. In 1918, Dr. Ambedkar wrote a paper which is on the economic development of India. And in fact laid down a theory of economic development for India. Very powerful paper. The kind of paper and argument that he has given, which were later on developed by Arthur Lewis, American economist, and converted into a book, big book, and he got a Nobel Prize for that particular idea. He may not be knowing that Dr. Ambedkar wrote that paper in 1980, but that idea was first conceived by Dr. Ambedkar. Then in 1942 and 1946, he was a labor minister. And he did number of things as a labor minister, I'll share with you very briefly. But what did he say in 1918 paper? It was a theory of economic development where he argued that agriculture, in agriculture there is a lot of poverty simply because agriculture is underdeveloped. And agriculture is underdeveloped simply because income in agriculture is low. And income in agriculture is low because the productivity is low, there is no use of capital, there is excessive use of labor. So he developed the concept of what is called idle labor and surplus labor. Surplus labors are formally defined another thing by Arthur Lewis, but he developed that concept of ideal labor, which he also took away from one of the British economists, but expanded in his. That take away this ideal labor from agriculture for the industry, industry will get the labor at a lower wages, industry can be developed. In agriculture, the pressure on land will be get reduced, size of land holding will increase, surplus will be generated, invested in agriculture, productivity will increase. So he said the way to industrial development and overall economic development is to develop agriculture by shifting the labor from agriculture to industry. Our entire second five plan was based on this idea, Manu Lobby's plan, industrialization through transfer of labor. But he also got an opportunity in 1942 and 44, when he was a labor minister, to translate his theory into practice. So let us understand this. A lot of things of Ambedkar are hidden. We don't have the courage to bring it out. I brought out a book and brought out his role in economic development. The 1942-44 period is very important. We have a story here. It's very important. That is that the Second World War was coming to an end. And therefore, the Marshall Plan was prepared for Europe to reconstruct. Europe was completely destroyed. Entire infrastructure was completely destroyed. So Marshall Plan was the League of Nations under that created. Money was put together and infrastructure was developed. That's how we have Europe being built up very soon after Second World War. But those countries who participated in support of British and sent their soldiers, they were also planned for them. And India being the party to the Second World War, supporting British, lakhs of our soldiers were there. Many of our industries were converted into industries to produce defense goods. And consumption goods were stocked for buy. If you can go, you know this Madras, if you go to Bangalore, there's a sandal soap you might have known. It's still the sandal soap. Sandal soap were rough soap which were built up first time in Bangalore. The building is still there. To send to the military to wash the clothes. And when the Second World War was over, it was converted into a beautiful soap factory. The issue was all industries were to be converted from war material to consumption mode, industrial mode. The soldier will come back in lakhs and they will have to be rehabilitated. They will have to be given a job. Therefore, rehabilitation plan was made for India. British government put a lot of fun. And there was a planning committee. That planning committee was consist of the ministers. And Ambedkar, being a labor minister, he was a member. But he was the most literate person in economics. So he was given a lot of responsibility to prepare the reconstruction plan. And he brought his economic theory into reconstruction plan, industrial development, agriculture development. But there are two points I will make, and I will finish with this point because it took a lot of time to discuss. That as a labor member, he brought everything for the labor. Whatever exists for the labor today, it's all because of Dr. Ambedkar. Tribunal, I mean, if you want me to read out, then you will get an idea what it is contributed as far as his labor is concerned. But I will leave it now. You must only believe me that all that we exist as a labor law is because of tripartite agreement, maternity leave, and all other things was because of him. But there was also a portfolio called irrigation and power under him. And he developed a policy for irrigation and water. There was nothing at the center of, as far as irrigation was concerned. There was only one irrigation advisor. There was no ministry or nothing. But he took a lot of initiative. He did three things for irrigation and water. One, he developed a policy. I don't want to go into greater detail. Second, he set up an office. It was called Central Water Irrigation and Navigation Commission. They are today Central Water Commission and Central Electricity Authority. It was set up in 1942-43. He didn't stop there, but he also initiated the construction of the dam. The Damodar Dam is entirely because of Ambedkar's vision. It's called Damodar Valley Authority, cutting across, built up on the river, cutting across three. Then Hirakund, he laid down the foundation stone of Hirakund. Son River, River of Deccan. So if you have a ministry of water and power today, it's all because of Ambedkar. But all were hidden in file. When the Dr. Ambedkar's birth centenary was being selected, the Central Water Commission people came to me. Somebody told them that Surat can do this work. They came to me that we have heard that Dr. Ambedkar has done something for water. I say, I am a student of Dr. Ambedkar, but I don't know. But nevertheless, if you say that, they gave me 1 lakh rupees and I work and produce that work. And it was all disclosed. That the Nehruji, which described at the time of inauguration ceremony of Hirakud, he said that these are our temples. But fortunately, history is also at time very interesting. The person who was chairing that function was Khosla. And Dr. Ambedkar appointed Khosla as the chairman of the Central Water Commission, Central Water and Power Commission. He was the engineer at the Dhaka. And he had, by that time he has retired, Ambedkar has resigned, but inauguration founding stone was there in Bhubaneswar. Nehruji went. Khosla was the governor and he was chairing, and he reminded the crowd. They say, this is the temple which was built up by Dr. Ambedkar. He is the founder of water and power policy. He reminded Nehruji and he reminded everybody. Now, these are the national issues. I put that into that book, 5 lectures of Dr. Ambedkar on water and power development. Now, this is the national contribution in nation development. Water, power. Power was in the private, he brought it to government. So, labor and power. Now let me now come to the last 2 points, and that is the what is his contribution to our minorities and the idea of nation. The idea of nation is already embedded into our preamble. That this is a republic, a democratic, secular, socialist. It has no basis of in religion. This is the idea of idea and goal or objective of the nation, they are already defined in the preamble of this country. But he was aware about several tendencies that are likely to come in, and therefore he devoted some of his energy to the concept of the problem of minority and the the concept of nation. Just give me a minute and then, because I'd like to read out certain paragraph to you so that you are aware about it. Let me come to minority issue first. When the issue of minority came, it was there for discussion right from 1920. Religious minority and social minority. Religious minority, Muslim, Anglo-Indian, and Christians, they already had some political rights. They were separately voted for Muslim, and there were certain nomination for others. Dr. Ambedkar, taking clue from them, he asked for the untouchable. He defined minority as a unit slightly differently. He said that the population is not the only criteria for a group to be a minority. In addition to the population, the group must be economically poor, educationally backward. That's the genuine definition of minority he tried to give. But when the issues of Muslim came in, their right, and their political right and others, in the early 40s and mid 40s,